काम करो।
वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून। हेलो,
हाँ मैम स्टार्ट करिए।
अ वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून। आई सी आशिता शाह एक्सटेंड अ वेरी वार्म कॉन्विवियल वेलकम टू ऑल द डिग्निटरीज ऑन टुडेज वीसीएम ऑन वाव सीरीज ऑन ट्रांसफर प्राइसिंग। बिफोर वी स्टार्ट आई रिक्वेस्ट एवरीवन टू राइज फॉर आर ICAI मोटो। कैन वी हैव द मोटो प्लीज प्लीज।
येष सुप्तेषु जागृति येष सुप्तेषु जागृति कामं 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 कामशो पुरुषो निर्विमाणः निर्विमाणः तदेव शुक्रं तदेव शुक्रद्ब्रह्मा तद्ब्रह्मा तदेवामृतमुच्यते तस्मिन् लोकः शतः सर्वतदूनाचर्यकश्च नात्यतीतश्च एतद्वैत
मैडम माइक ऑन करिए।
सॉरी। एज वी ऑल आर अवेयर ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट इन टैक्सेशन एंड अकाउंटिंग Transfer pricing refers to the rules and methods for pricing transactions within and between enterprises under common ownership. Transfer pricing refers to the terms and conditions which associate enterprises agree for their controlled transactions. We have with us today a speaker to give us deep insights on this wonderful topic, CA Aparna Khatri. Welcome, ma'am. I request CA Bhavna Radheshwar to formally introduce our speaker for the day. Over to you, Bhavna Madam.
Thank you, CA Ashita Shah. And I am Bhavna Radheshwar. I am privileged to introduce today's faculty to enlighten us on this knowledge sharing platform. CA Aparna Khatri, today's speaker. She's a chartered accountant and registered valuer by profession. CA Aparna Khatri has close to 2 decades of post-qualification experience, including more than a decade in Big Four accounting firms. She is currently associated with Rajshree, Sabnavis and Associate as a consulting director. She has handled assignments spanning from domestic tax to international tax, including transfer pricing. She has assisted clients on taxation aspects ranging from pre-setup advisory to structuring, implementation, and ongoing compliance, business transfer advisory to due diligence and implementation, services and intangibles benchmarking, including advising and defending clients on AMP-related aspects, intercompany transaction policy setting, including for value chain structures, spread across entities are some of the projects she has handled. She has also been involved in tax officer representation all the way up to the appellate forum and before the advanced pricing agreement authorities. Her client service experience spans across MNCs, both Indian and overseas, across industries like media and entertainment, telecom, software services, and manufacturing, to name a few. More recently, she has added valuation to her set of proficiencies. Her articles have been published by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India 3 times in a row in their esteemed publication, Valuation Professionals Insight. So I welcome CA Aparna Khatri, ma'am, to take the session and enlighten all of us on this knowledge sharing platform.
Thank you, Ashita. Thank you, Bhavna. Thank you for the very warm welcome. And now it's my time to welcome everyone. I know it is close to the end of the year and everyone is wondering why are we being bothered with a topic like transfer pricing. But we will soon learn as we go ahead in the session why it is important. So at the outset, a very warm welcome to everyone and a very big thank you to WRC for giving me this opportunity. There are three reasons why I believe this is kind of close to my heart today. One is hosting it on a platform like WRC. We've been associated, as you all said, with ICI for like 20 years. And before that, a lot of hard work went into becoming a CA. So ICI is close to heart and WRC, of course, where we belong. The second is transfer pricing is one of my favorite topics. I can just talk endlessly. And that is why maybe you've given me only 2 hours to put a tap on things. And the last but not the least is this year transfer pricing completes 20 years. And it's a real honor that before we wrap up calendar year 2021, I'm being given a chance to talk about the subject. As we go along the way, you will see how the subject has evolved and thankfully in a very positive manner, keeping the interest of the both the country as well as the various corporates and other entities that operate in India, making it more easier and simpler in that sense. So while tax interest as well as ease of business has been kept in mind while making the changes, we'll see how when we go ahead with the slides. So thank you so much. I'll just start the session then. Ashita, is it visible?
Yes,
yes, madam.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. So I'll just start. So basically, when we talk of transfer pricing, what are we talking of? Everyone must have heard it in bits and pieces. So basically, what transfer pricing aims at doing is to control or keep a tab on the transactions that happen between group entities. We know that bulk of the trade, bulk of the business happens between associated enterprise or group entities or MNCs. And what happens is that, and when this concept was introduced, that the feeling was that there was a lot of trade which was happening to shift profits from one territory to the other, or to shift profits between entities such that tax was saved. And so India introduced this legislation as back 20 years back. It is, you will find this subject in a lot of regulations. It's not just income tax. You will find it in indirect tax laws also. Say GST also has provisions related to transactions with related parties. Customs law also have transactions when you are transacting with related parties. You have the Companies Act, which has whole provisions which pertain to related party transactions. Section 188 is what governs it. SEBI has rules in place for transactions with related parties. So you will see that there is a lot of regulations which control related party transactions. And why so? There are reasons for the same, as I mentioned earlier. So there are, every law has its own intention or intention when it is introducing this concept. When you look at it from a Companies Act point of view, the idea is to govern, to ensure that there is no value erosion in the company. They also take care of that the minor interest or the minor investor's interest is protected. So profits or money is not being shifted between entities without consent, or in an unfair manner, and also that the financial statements present the current state of affairs. So this is something that is looked at by both the Companies Act and if you're a listed company by SEBI. So the first three blocks are towards preserving interest and protection of the entity value, investor value. The next block is about your impact on tax liability. When I talk of tax liability, it could be direct tax as well as indirect tax. So the income tax you pay or the GST that you pay or the customs duty that you pay, the value at which you transact is directly impacts the tax that you pay. Why it is important, why we are discussing this is also because the authorities have been given overriding powers. We will see it as we move along, that the authorities have a right to relook at your transaction, reset the price at which you have transacted, disregard the price at which you have transacted, and maybe in extreme cases also disregard the transaction itself, And that is why you ought to keep your affairs in order. And last but not the least, there are penal consequences if you don't comply with the law. It is not only restricted to paying of additional taxes. There is interest obligation. Also, there are penal consequences. And sometimes it is so high that it far outweighs the tax savings that you would have done by designing your affairs in that manner. Because this topic is so wide and it is practically impossible for me to cover it in 2 hours, what the focus of today's session is that we restrict our discussions only to Income Tax Act so that we can have a bird's eye view of what are all the provisions that are relevant from transfer pricing point of view. My idea is not to make the session very technical. The idea is to give you snippets of what is there in the regulation, some guidance in terms of what the courts have held, some practical guidance when you are actually implementing the law, some practical guidance in terms of how you do documentation, what do you take care of. And so that all of us, so maybe some of you all have already done it, some of you all may not have done it. The idea is to keep it at a level where all of us can take something home. If there are any questions, I would urge you to keep it for the end so that we can complete the slides for everyone's benefit. And if there are specific questions, we can address it at the end. I'll start on the income tax. So basically, when we talk of approach to TPR, before I get into the nuances or before I get into the specific sections, what I've done in this chart is try to give a sense of what is the end-to-end process from an income tax point of view. And what is it that you need to start from? What is what are all the steps that you need to undertake to reach a final destination? So the first step is that you need to identify whether there is an enterprise, and more the way the word enterprise is defined, which also includes a permanent establishment, is that practically any person will fall under the purview of enterprise. So that definition can be found in 92F. Then there is a definition for associated enterprise. Who is covered by this law? So an entity who's transacting with an associated enterprise is covered by this law. Also a related party or connected persons when we come to SDT. But just for simplicity purposes, I'm just discussing this chart from an international tax point of view. The principles will be the same when you are doing a SDT documentation also. Then we next go on to see what is a transaction. There is the definition of transaction is important. It will give you a sense of what you need to look at. Then once you have identified there is a transaction, you need to see whether it is an international transaction. There are conditions prescribed there. Also, you need to check whether your client or you, if you are in the tax team of the company itself, whether there are any specific domestic transactions that you need to take care of. Once you have done all of this identification work, then you go on to the analysis part of it. You first try to gather information regarding the group, your client. I'm assuming your client for the moment is the Indian entity. So you have a client who is the Indian entity, who is just maybe a subsidiary of a UK company or a US company. So you try to understand what is the group profile, which is the parent entity, which are the various group entities, what is the group into, what is the Indian entity doing, what is its relationship with its other group entities, as in how does it transact with it, how is it dependent on the other group entities. Then you will focus on the transactions which you have identified. So now from a macro level, you come to a micro level where your focus is on the transactions that have been undertaken. You will try to understand what are the terms of the transaction, written and unwritten both. So every time you may not have a very well documented agreement, because in group entities, more often than not, you have business which is transacted on emails and many a times on the phone as well. So you may not have everything very diligently done. So the onus is all the more on trying to find out those kind of arrangements which may be skipped or maybe missed out in case there's no formal agreement in writing. Once you have understood the transaction and what are the terms of the transaction between the parties, the next function for you is to do a FAR analysis. So as we go along this, the journey of transfer pricing, you will hear me talking about a lot of this jargon like FAR analysis, economic analysis, associated enterprises. These are germane to transfer pricing. This has been in place. It's there globally, and the language that we speak spans across countries. So these are the terms which will be used across countries. It's not specific to India. The Indian regulations, transfer pricing regulations, have been are kind of based on the OECD guidelines and which the world follows. So whatever we talk of is something which even the other overseas enterprises will be accustomed to. So what is a FAR analysis? I will discuss it as we move along. Then we talk of, once you have done the FAR analysis, we will characterize the parties. I will again discuss that in the later section. And then we do the benchmarking, that is the actual number crunching or actually finding out what is the arm's length price of the transaction. Once you have done all of this, and as you do this all the way along, you will prepare your documentation. And based on all of this, you will complete your filing. So this is the journey that you cover when you are doing any kind of transfer pricing work. Now we start with the specific sections. Section 92 is the, what should I say? If you call transfer pricing a universe, then section 92 is your sun with all the sections, maybe your planets and all the rules which help you implement these sections are your maybe satellites like the moon, which is revolving around. But everything is based on section 92. The center of your transfer pricing regulations is section 92. So it says that, and I've just captured 92.1. There is a lot more in the section. But the moot point is that section 92 says that any income or expenditure arising from an international transaction shall be computed having regard to arm's length price. This is a substantive provision. You have to look at this first, okay? And basis this, then you will decide whether transfer pricing is applicable or otherwise. And you will see in some other cases, when, as we discussed, that from a precaution point of view, although in some cases section 92 may not be satisfied, still to avoid penalties, people do compliances. Then we go to, once section 92 is triggered, you have to ensure that you follow the process that we discussed in the previous slide and you maintain documentation. We start with identifying associated enterprise. Now, what is an associated enterprise? It is defined in the Act in Section 92A. Section 92A has two parts. So the broad theme is that either one entity has control in the other entity or is participating in the other entity by way of, say, maybe controlling, having participation in the management or having a capital share in that company. Or there is one company which is holding stake in two companies, in which case the two companies will be considered as associated enterprise. This is the broad theme of Section 92A1. This is a general concept, okay? But to understand what, how you will apply it, you have to refer to Section 92A2. Section 92A2 has 13 clauses. And out of that, the 13th clause, practically nothing has been prescribed till date. So I will talk about the 12 clauses. So there are various relationships. I will not cover everything. But just to give you a sense of what you need to look at is, so for example, let's take Clause A. What Clause A says that if there is one entity which participates in the capital of the other entity by having a share capital carrying more than 26% of voting right. So in that case, so say you have entity A, A Inc., which is situated outside India, say in the US, let's take the example of, say, Apple. So Apple Inc. has a subsidiary of Apple India. And Apple Inc. is holding almost entire stake in Apple India. So in this case, because Apple Inc. is holding more than 26% voting power shares in Apple India, they two will be considered to be an associated enterprise. Or say, for example, if I apply Clause B, say there is another Apple India 2, then Apple, all of these entities will be considered as associated enterprise. Or say you have an Apple Japan. Then Apple India and Apple Japan will also be considered to be as associated enterprise because they have a common parent, or there is one entity which is holding more than 26% stake in both these entities. So these two sections, why I spoke of, because this is the most commonly found relationship, because we find that there is one entity, the ultimate parent entity, who has various step-down subsidiaries through which it holds entities across the world. And because of that common entity, you will find all of these group entities are associated enterprises. Then there are other deeming sections where, you know, there is a loan given by one entity which is equal or more to 51% of the book value of the assets. So on and so forth. There are three main parts. That is, either you're participating in capital or you're participating in management. Say you are appointing more than half of the directors, half of the board. Or you are kind of having control over the executive body. So you have to apply this, of course, in intent and see that whether there is, maybe you are not participating by way of share capital to the extent of 26%, but if you have the power to call the shots in terms of how the company is managed, then you will still be associated. The other kind of control that you may have is by way of commercial relationship. So there is no participation in management. There is no participation in your share capital, but you are maybe controlling the other entity by way of giving it the patent or the trademark or a distribution right, without which that entity cannot function. Or you're supplying majority of the raw materials, so on and so forth. Then there are the balance, the three clauses pertain to entities which are non-corporates. So ownership by individuals or the relative, or there is an HUF, a member of the HUF controlling or his relative. So what you need to do is, I have just simplified this to give you a sense of what are the different kind of relationships that you look at when you are evaluating a relationship. So just because the entity is not the so-called owner, as we say it in common parlance, so it does not necessarily mean that that entity may not be the associated enterprise. You have to go through all the 12 clauses and see that you are not ticking off the box on any one of them. Okay. And if you are safe on all 12 counts, only then you can conclusively say that the entities are not associated enterprises. How do you read this section? So there has been some controversy around this section. I just thought I'll spend 2 or 3 minutes on this because it's important. It forms the basis for you to identify which are the entities whose transactions you have to look at. So when this section was introduced like 20 years back, there was some discussion around the language of the section, and the question was whether you see the general control, you see the general participation, which is provided in 92A1, or you read it along with 92A2. So there was in some cases, because there are some cases where you'll find that maybe one is getting satisfied, two is not getting satisfied, or in other cases two is getting satisfied but one is not getting satisfied. So what do you do in such a situation? So in the early days when there were no rulings on this concept, we used to fall back on the Memorandum of Finance Bill, and if you read the language, it was very clear that just because 92A1 is getting satisfied, that is how you generally say that someone is participating in capital management or control. Unless there is one of the clauses in 92A2 which is getting satisfied, you cannot call them associated enterprise. In spite of the language of the finance bill being so clear, the memorandum being so clear, we still found that there were rulings or there were still cases where the tax office was not applying this. And it has traveled all the way to ITAT and in fact even to High Court. So a few years back in the case of KB Private Limited, Mumbai Tribunal said that you have to view both of them independently. So even if you tick off A1, then you are associated enterprises, or you tick off A2, you are associated enterprise. However, the Gujarat High Court has decided this in favor of the taxpayers, saying that you have to read 92A1 and 92A2 together. So unless you satisfy one of those 12 deeming clauses, then you will not be construed to be an associated enterprise. There was a special leave petition which was filed against this order by the revenue authorities before the Supreme Court, which has been dismissed. So by and large, we can say that this is the law of the land today. An interesting ruling which came up recently, which I thought we should discuss, is in the case of Page Industries. So Page Industries is the Indian distributor, a manufacturer distributor of Jockey brand of apparels. So Jockey brand is owned by Jockey US. And it has given rights to Page Industries in India. It's a listed company to manufacture the Jockey branded products and also to sell it in India. And this arrangement has been in place for various number of years. So what the tax office said is, because Page Industries cannot operate without the license given by Jockey US, then Page Industries and Jockey US are associated enterprises. What Page Industries said that maybe I am dependent on the rights of given by Jockey US. But my management is not run by Jockey US. Jockey US does not have any say in the way I run my company. In fact, I'm a listed company. So they said that although 92A2 may be satisfied in my case, but 92A1 is not getting satisfied. So they are not participating in my management control or capital. The High Court held that because Page Industries was able to demonstrate that it operated in an independent fashion, it was not an associated enterprise of Jockey US. So this was an interesting ruling, but it all comes down to the facts of the case. And we should do a robust analysis before we come to a conclusion either sides. There are a couple of more things that I just wanted to point out over here is, say maybe there are times when you have, so the law says that there are deeming provisions which have to be read very strictly. So just because the SSC by mistake reports someone as an AE, say you reported it by mistake or your client reported it by mistake, and you can always tell the officer at a later stage that this is an error and these are not related enterprises or associated enterprises. And the AO is bound to look at the law and then decide whether it is an AE or not. So just because you made a mistake of reporting someone as an AE, that doesn't make it one. The other two points which are relevant over here is because it is a deeming law, it has to be read very strictly. So you cannot aggregate the stake across entities. So say, for example, we are looking at the clause where there is a loan given by one entity, which constitutes more than 51% of the total assets of the other entity. In that case, you have to read the section as one enterprise only. So for example, there are two group entities. So there is A UK and B UK who have given loan to C India. A UK has given 20%. C UK has given, say, maybe 35%, okay, of the total assets value. Maybe together they are breaching the 51% threshold, but individually they are not. So what the case law over here says that you cannot aggregate. You read the section properly. It talks of one enterprise, and there is not one single enterprise who is crossing the threshold, so they cannot be considered to be associated enterprises. So this is, I'll just leave this here. There's a lot more to cover. Once you have identified all the associated enterprises, you list them down, okay? And you plot your rationale against them as to why you have selected that particular entity as an associated enterprise. It's very important that as you do this, you keep documenting whatever you are doing. And I will tell you, you will hear me saying this a lot, and there are reasons why I am saying this. There is a lot of emphasis on documentation and transfer pricing. So when you do this entire process, whether you accept someone as an associated enterprise, you identify something as a transaction or otherwise, please keep documenting it. So what is a transaction? Now, the way the term transaction has been defined is very wide. It's an inclusive definition. It includes an arrangement. It is an understanding or an action in concert. It is not important that this arrangement is in writing or is just oral. And it is not also important that the parties can sue each other in the court. So a transaction could be a tacit understanding also, where nothing is written. Just by participation, maybe you all know that you have to obey a particular entity, or the boss is supreme and you have to listen to it. So that is an unsaid arrangement between the parties. So when there is an instruction coming from the HQ that you have to bear this share of the cost allocation, you have to bear it. So although you may have don't have an email or you don't have a written agreement, but still when the allocation note comes to you, you will pay that money. So that is what is included in transaction. Even free of cost transactions are included in transaction. So maybe there is someone who is providing any kind of, say, HR help or any other kind of supervision services, and there is no price charge for it, still it is a transaction. Now we go to what is an international transaction. So 92B has again two subparts to it. It is important to understand each of the part carefully because they operate in different spheres. So when you talk of 92B1, it is a transaction between two or more A's, either or both of whom are non-residents. So we have two parties transacting. More often than not, you will see an overseas entity and one Indian entity. You will say that at least one of them is a non-resident. So it's an international transaction between the two of them. At times, transactions between two non-residents will also fall under the purview of the section, provided it pertains to an India-sourced income. So the catch here is that any one of the two should be non-resident for it to qualify as an international transaction. The definition is very, very wide. Honestly speaking, in my entire career, and especially after the amendment in 2012, I have not come across any transaction which will not fall under the purview of the term international transaction, provided that one of them is an non-resident. So it is very, very widely defined. It includes tangible transactions, intangible transactions, services, business restructuring, cost allocation, financing transactions, guarantee transactions. So everything is covered here. Also, there is a subsection which has, there's an explanation provided where there is a big laundry list of intangibles mentioned. You should go through it to get a sense of what all, it's a very good reference in terms of what all intangibles are covered. So there is marketing technology related stuff. There's data processing. To say marketing, when we talk of marketing, maybe you have a brand which is there. You have a good contract with the advertising agency. You have technology. Say, for example, when you look at any technology, say, for example, Zerodha is high on the technology front. It's got its unique platform. Or say, for example, you are a car manufacturer who self-driving car. That technology is unique. So all of this is intangible property. It could be engineering, customer related. Your customer contracts is an intangible. You have human capital, which is resources that you have, which are hard to replace. You have goodwill related intangibles, the brand value. It's not just the brand, but the goodwill that you build in the market. Say the Tata brand is a brand in itself, but it comes with a lot of goodwill. So you have certain procedures, systems, programs, which you have put in place. You have customer list. We know that a lot of the e-com companies drive a lot of value because of the number of users that they have. Whether they buy or not, I don't know. But looking at your user base, all of these apps and all of these platforms, their valuations run very high. The long and short of it is anything that is not, cannot be seen or felt, but it has some kind of value, I'm talking in layman terms, is an intangible. So that is what you should look at when you are looking at transaction between group entities. This leg is important. Just pardon me for a minute. This part is a little different from what we discussed earlier. The concept of deemed international transaction has been in place since the very beginning. The theme of this concept is that you just cannot skirt the law by interposing a third party where the intent is actually to have a transaction between group entities. So just by interposing a third party in the entire arrangement or in the equation, you cannot get rid of the compliances under transfer pricing. So what this says is that, what this section says is that where there is a transaction with a third party, okay, but it is dictated by the related party or by the associated enterprise, then in that case, even though it is a transaction between two third parties, it will be considered as one between associated enterprises. So the clauses that you have to look at is whether there exists a prior agreement in relation to the relevant transactions between such other person and the AE. So in our instance, in the chart that I have below, we have A Inc. US, we have A Limited India, and we have Z Limited, who's a third party. So A and A Inc. and A Limited are associated enterprises, and Z is a third party. Now A Inc. Is the brand owner. Say you can look at a company like Gap, who sells shirts and other apparel, and it is asking A Limited India to sell the products or distribute the products across the retail value chain in India. And A Limited doesn't have a manufacturing plant. A Inc. says, don't worry, I have a local manufacturer who will manufacture the shirts. I have given him all the technical specifications. He will sell the shirts to you. You have to ensure that you buy them at XYZ price. Okay. So now what is happening is A Limited India is transacting with Z Limited, who is a manufacturer of the shirts for Gap. And it will procure the shirts from Gap and sell it in the local market. But this contract is driven by the arrangement between A Inc. and Z Limited. Okay. So while the contract in India or the purchase bill will happen between A Limited India and Z Limited India, because it is A Inc. which is calling the shots over here in terms of who you buy the products from, at what price do you buy them, then it will be considered to be a deemed international transaction. So why I'm discussing this in detail is many a times you will have your clients or your company itself who will transact with a third party in India. Say, for example, your group has a deal with Dell to say that, you know, globally, all the XYZ group companies will buy laptops only from Dell. So maybe you will purchase it from a Dell India. But if it is governed by the deal that your parent has with Dell US or whichever is the parent entity, then in that case, this will fall under the purview of deemed international transaction. I agree that many a times it is in fact beneficial because of these global deals. You get the product at very good prices. You get preferred customer service, so on and so forth. But it doesn't take away from the fact that it will fall under the definition of this term. You will have to prove how it is a transaction. That is a different thing. But yes, it will fall under the purview of this section. Another change that was brought in this law was earlier, the transaction should have been a cross-border transaction. So A Limited India should have transacted with Z Limited, say, who was maybe a Chinese manufacturer. Okay. And so it was mandatory that it was a cross-border deal. But a couple of years back, there was a change which was brought in this section. And now even transaction between two resident entities will qualify it as a deemed international transaction. So we typically miss out on this because we say it is an Indian resident transaction or it is a third party. And maybe you are not asking the right questions and that is why you may not get this information. So it is important that we keep these things in mind. There is a concept of SDT or a specified domestic transaction. This came in around 10 years or so back. And the idea was that to take care of profit shifting between Indian entities. Okay. So there has been evolution in this section also, but I'll just stick to the key point over here. So basically, we knew that earlier there was a tax regime of 10A, 10AA, where the tax holiday units would get exemption deductions in terms of their taxable profits, and there was quite a lot of saving on the taxation front. So what was happening is the experience was that more and more profits were being shifted from the taxable units to these tax-free or the tax holiday entities or units within the same legal entity. So this law was brought about and it still is there. It says that whenever there are transactions between the tax holiday units or the entities with another unit or another entity who is not enjoying these holidays, or maybe it is still enjoying holidays, maybe at a different rate. In that case, these transactions will be covered under the purview of specified domestic transactions, and you will have to undertake the necessary compliance. What is relevant today because most of the tax holidays have kind of been, the sunset clause has come in and nothing is really operative today. But I am discussing this because it is important if you have a client or if your company is a newly set up manufacturing entity who's planning to claim the benefit under section 115 BAB, that is the low tax regime. So if your transactions with closely connected persons is going to cross the threshold limit of 20 crores, then you will fall under the purview of SDT. So that is that is what you need to focus on over here. And even if your transaction doesn't cross the threshold of 20 crores, still in substance TP will apply to you. Maybe you will not need to do those compliances, but in substance you will have to prove how your profits are ordinary, more than ordinary. I will discuss that in the next slide. So there is the one which we are discussing now. So this concessional tax regime says that if you are a manufacturing entity, domestic company, which ticks off the conditions which are mentioned in the said section, then you are taxable at a rate of 15% plus cess and surcharge. This 15% tax rate is applicable where you are generating profit from a manufacturing entity, from a manufacturing activity. The law says that now in section 115 BAB, this provision is there, that if the AO finds out that due to close connection between this tax holiday entity and another party, or due to any other reason, you are arranging your business in such a way that the eligible company, this tax holiday entity, is getting more than ordinary profits, then in that case, the AO has the power to limit your profits which are eligible for the 15% tax rate. The balance profits will be taxable at the highest rate of 30%. So although you may not cross the threshold of 20 crores that we discussed in the previous slide, but still you will have to ensure that the profits that are being earned by this entity are satisfying this clause. And to do that, you will have to resort to the transfer pricing provisions because that is the only section or the only regulation which gives you some kind of guidance as to how do you demonstrate to the tax officer that your transactions are in the ordinary course of business, are not more than ordinary. And the process is laid out there, which you can follow in this case also. So that is the limited reason why SDT is important today. And if SDT is not applicable, then either ways 115 BAB has to be complied with. There are some other provisions which I thought we should cover, which maybe explicitly you don't look at it from a TP point of view, but the TP principles are important when you are applying these sections. The first section is 40A2. So 40A2 basically covers payments made by one entity one person to another related party. The gamut of this provision is only for payment transactions where you are claiming an expenditure. It is not. It does not cover income transactions. It does not cover allowances. Say, for example, there's depreciation on an asset which you would have purchased from a related party. So only expenses for which you're claiming an allowance is a deduction is what is covered over here. You can read the provision, but basically the long and short of it is the expenditure will be considered to be as excessive if one of the three criteria is that you have to ensure that it is considered excessive if you have paid more than the fair market value of the goods or the services or the facilities of which the payment is made. Now, the term fair market value is an abstract term. There is nothing specifically defined. How do you go about doing it? And this is where you can resort to the or to fall back on the transfer pricing provisions, the mechanisms which are provided to make a case that what has been paid is at fair market value. It is not excessive. It is not unreasonable. In fact, till a couple of years back, 48-2 transactions were also part of the SDT regime. But it was brought out because there was a lot of representation being made that it is a headache. And when there is money sitting in India only, then why do you want people to undertake so much of compliance? So this was removed from the SDT provisions. So this is one place where you can apply the TP methods that we will discuss going forward. The other is Section 94A. So here, Section 94A is an anti-abuse provision. Basically, what it's trying to do is, if there is any country or territory which is notified by the Indian government, because of the fact that it is a non-cooperative country or it has a tax rate of, say, maybe less than 15%, they notify those countries. And if you have transactions with entities who are sitting in these countries, even if it is a third party, by operation of this section, it will be considered to be an associated enterprise and the transactions with those entities will fall under the purview of transfer pricing. So you have to do everything from identifying the parties to identifying the transactions to benchmarking the transactions to maintaining documentation, filing, so on and so forth. So till some time back, Cyprus was one of the entities, or rather Cyprus was the only entity which was notified. But because of increased cooperation between Cyprus and the Indian government, Cyprus was removed from the list. So maybe as of today, you don't have an entity which falls under this particular section. But this is something that you need to keep tab on, because you may miss this in case you are transacting with a third party located in that jurisdiction. Last but not the least is GAR. So this is General Anti-Avoidance Rules. This is like the mother of all sections, I should say, because it sits over every other section. So you may all the criteria mentioned in the other section. You have done everything right, which is prescribed in the other section. But when you look at it from a GAR lens, it just doesn't make sense. Transaction, the arrangement, or the series of arrangements look fishy. Or maybe one leg of the arrangement is not in sync with the others, and it is just imposed in the arrangement to ensure a tax benefit. So GAR gives very, very wide powers to the revenue authority to kind of redo the entire transaction if they find that it is an impermissible avoidance agreement. So if the transaction has been undertaken only to get a tax benefit, and plus there are some other criteria, say substance is not there, so on and so forth. Of the other criteria, one of the criteria is it is creating rights or obligations which are not ordinarily created between persons dealing at arm's length. So even if you have a transaction with a third party, if it does not satisfy the common sense smell test or whatever term you want to call it, and the terms are fishy, or you know, it is not something that you would have ideally done in a normal situation with any other third party, then you need to be mindful that that transaction can be picked up for scrutiny, and you will have to show that how you are ticking off all the criteria for it not to be an impermissible avoidance agreement. And one of it is the transaction is at arm's length. So when there are sizable transactions, which you know could fit in the GAR threshold of more than 3 crores, where there is tax impact of more than 3 crores, it is always advisable, in addition to looking at it from a substance point of view, to also see whether you will be able to justify it from an arm's length point of view. So that is where TP comes into play. Now, we come to the more interesting side of things. We have understood all the law, the theory, who is there, what they are doing, so on and so forth. Now, what do we actually do once we have identified who the entities are and what the transactions are? So there are two parts to it. One is the FAR part of it, and one is the EA. So it is, we commonly call it as FA and EA. So FAR analysis is the FA and EA is the economic analysis. FAR is understanding the nuances of the transaction, okay, and what the parties are doing. And economic analysis is the number crunching part of it. So when we talk of FAR, what does it mean? FAR is a abbreviation for functions, assets, and risk. Okay. What you need to do is you need to understand, and for this, you need to do conversations with the management. You need to set up interviews. You need to ask the right questions. and understand who in the value chain is doing what. So you will ask questions about functions performed, who is doing what, assets employed, who is investing in what, okay? And the assets employed may not always be bought out assets. You may own them, you may not own them, you may lease them, you may borrow them. But you are basically deploying those assets. And what are the risks undertaken by the parties to the transaction? Who is the risk-bearing entity? How much of risk is being borne? Are they sharing a risk? Is one a risk-free entity? So on and so forth. Once you do all of this, and I have a sample given after this. Once you have done this, you have to then conclude. Characterization is nothing but conclusion. Draw your conclusion in terms of between the two parties, who is the entrepreneur or the business owner or whatever word you want to call it, and who is the risk-free entity. Typically, whenever we do a benchmarking exercise, it is always done with respect to the tested party. I will discuss that later, but just hear me out here because this is the steps that you follow. So once you do the FAR analysis, once you come to your conclusions that who's the risk-bearing and the relatively risk-free entity, you will characterize them as an entrepreneur or a risk-free or a low-risk or a medium-risk entity. And basis that whoever is the simpler of the two entities, who is having the less of ticks on the FAR side, that will be your tested party, okay? So say, for example, you have a foreign company. Let's take the example of Gap. Gap US is the entity who is owning the brand, who will give you the design specifications, who will tell you what cloth to use, who will tell you that this is how you have to promote it. And it tells Gap India that you sell the products in India. You retain a fixed margin of, say, maybe 5, 7, 10% on your top line. And only if you make a profit, then you send the balance to me. So in this case, what is happening is Gap US is the intangible owner also. Gap US is the risk-bearing entity also. And Gap India is the lesser function, lesser risk-bearing, and one who's also employing lesser assets, as maybe compared to, it depends on what is being done over here. And so Gap India will be the tested party over here. And once you decide who is the tested party, then you will decide on which method to apply, because it is for this entity that you will apply one of these methods. Why I have put this as a point is, this is, see, one is when you are following methods, the other is common sense. Whenever you have an entity which is bearing more functions, assuming more risk or deploying more capital or more assets, the expectation is that there is a higher reward for it, or there should be a higher profit that should be attributed to those kind of functions. So like we say, higher the risk, higher the rewards, it is equally applicable to the F and the A, F and the A also. So here I have given an example of the kind of things that you need to look at when you're writing the FAR for a purchase transaction. So there is an Indian entity who's purchasing goods for resale. So you will see who's doing the strategic management functions, who's doing the day-to-day running, who's doing the product development, who's protecting the brand, who's protecting the designs, who's conceptualizing, who's designing, who's doing the research, who's procuring, who's doing the inbound, outbound logistics. Who's promoting and to what extent is the promotion being done? What is the sales function involved? Is it easy to do, not easy to do? How much of pains do you have to undergo to distribute the products in India? After sales service, how important? So this is what you will, these are the questions that you will ask when you are looking at the purchase of goods for resale transaction. One thing that I wanted to draw everyone's attention to here is, especially in the context of this kind of a transaction, so where there is an Indian distributor, or say there is an Indian agent, when you are asking these questions, we have to be mindful that the answers may lead us to a conclusion that the foreign entity has a permanent establishment in India. It is not true in all cases, but in certain cases, it may lead to a conclusion that the foreign entity is practically having an agent in India through which his business is carried out. It could be construed to be a fixed place PE. It could be a dependent agency PE. So what you find out from a TP point of view is equally important from a tax point of view, and vice versa also. So it is very important that when we make these documents, we look at it both from a tax lens as well as a transfer pricing lens. And one cannot operate in isolation of the other. Here, what I've captured is the typical risk that we find in a purchase sale transaction. So there is business risk, there is technology obsolescence. So say, for example, you are a distributor of phones in India and the version that you're having is outdated and nobody wants to buy it. So there is technology obsolescence. So you are left with a pile of phones which are worth, to be sold for scrap. So that is something. Or maybe you are selling laptops which are not functional or not fast enough for the current generation. Or there is stuff like product development risk, which is sitting with the overseas entity. There is inventory risk, which is sitting with the Indian entity. There is credit collection risk, which the Indian entity is bearing. There is forex risk, which the Indian entity could bear or the foreign entity could bear. There is attrition risk. So the right set of people may leave you and you may not find replacement soon enough. There is intangible property related risk. So maybe everything is not applicable in a given case. I've just given some examples. And depending on the business that you are evaluating, you will have to check these aspects. The other part is what are the assets that are typically involved? So you have to think about what all would be required by both the Indian entity and the foreign entity. And you have to document that in terms of what are the tangibles in use, what are the intangibles in use, and what are the human resources that each of them have deployed. As I mentioned earlier, the entities don't need to own those assets. They could be leased out also. The important point is what are they deploying to get their business up and running. This I've discussed. Why do we undertake an economic analysis? This is the number crunching part of it now, where we start finding comparables. So very loosely speaking, economic analysis is also known as the comparability analysis. So basically, the why we are doing all of this is to prove that the transaction price or the price at which those two entities transacted is in sync with the arm's length price or is within the arm's length range, as we will see when we go forward. And that is the intent of this entire provision. How you do it is what I will discuss in this section. So there is a rule 10B which prescribes 6 methods. You ought to follow those methods and you cannot travel beyond those methods. And I will cite, once I've discussed the methods, I will see how the courts have upheld this, in fact, in the taxpayer's favor. Whatever comparable you find out, that has to be independent. I will discuss that when we take the cup example. And whatever comparable or comparables you find out, they should be similar, may not be same, but they need to be similar to the transaction that you are testing. At times, it may not be an exact comparable, but it should be. So when you are looking at a product, the degree of comparability should be higher. But maybe when you are looking at a company, the degree of comparability is low. But there should be some there should be some degree of comparability in both the cases. And you should have the ability to make adjustment if there are substantial differences. If you cannot remove the differences by making adequate adjustments or proper adjustments, then you have to drop that company as or that transaction or that product as a comparable. So what do you look at when you are determining comparability is what is the specific characteristic of what is being sold. So say, for example, you are evaluating a comparable for a car. You will see everything, not only that it is a Maruti. You will drill down what is the technical specifications, what is the power of the engine, what is it? Is it a petrol version? Is it a diesel version? Is it a SUV? Is it a family car? Whatever. So all of the technical specifications you will get into when you are trying to benchmark this car against any third party car. And only once the technical specifications match, will it be a comparable? If they do not match, then please, it is not a comparable. It could be something that you will loosely call as a comparable, but from a TP point of view, from a price and a comparison point of view, it is not a comparable. Contractual terms, important. You need to read the agreement or you need to understand what is the arrangement between the parties. Very critical. I'll give you an example. Say, for example, you are having a contract where the customer is diligent enough and he's paying you, in cash on time. And maybe you are happy enough to extend a 2%, 3% cash discount to him. But you have another third party who is paying you maybe 6 months down the line, 8 months down the line. Definitely, as a smart entrepreneur, you will factor in the interest cost when you are building the price for that third party agreement. So understanding the contractual terms is very relevant. Third is the FAR analysis of the transacting entity. Whatever you are trying to compare, it should be apples and apples. You cannot compare apples and say bananas or oranges or whatever. So what transaction you are looking at, whichever party you are evaluating, the comparable should be in similar state as that company. And the last is similarity of economic and market conditions. today you cannot compare a company's manufacturing company sitting in India, say with a manufacturing company sitting in Bangladesh or say China, especially when you have a good set of comparables sitting in India itself. The market conditions there are very different. Maybe there are government incentives which are given, labor is cheap to find. You have an advantage and you are able to bill at a higher margin, get a much better margin from the third party or the other way around. So you have to there have to be some similarities in the economic conditions in which your tested party is operating versus that the comparables are operating in. I'm running a little late. I'll pick the critical points over here. So when you're identifying comparables, it could be either an internal comparable. Internal means, say the Indian entity has a transaction with a third party, or the foreign entity has a transaction with a third party. So it is internal to the group. So the transaction is happening between the group itself, although with a third party. But either the Indian entity is having the transaction or the foreign company is having the transaction. That is always the better bet. If you don't find an internal comparable, then we go to an external comparable. External comparables you can source from databases which are there. And typically we see that being done more often than not, where we don't get a healthy comparable within the company itself. Indian tax office prefers Indian comparables. So Indian tax office always prefers that you select the Indian entity as a tested party and you find Indian comparables and accordingly benchmark your transactions. But there have been rulings where the courts have upheld that even the foreign entity can be considered as the tested party, and you benchmark the foreign entity against foreign comparables. This I have discussed, the importance of documentation. There are 6 methods prescribed. When you are selecting any method, critical points, what is the availability of data, how reliable it is, how much of adjustments you need to make, how close or far it is to the transaction, the product, the arrangement is what you need to look at before you decide on a method. This is the first method. We call it CUP, Comparable Uncontrolled Price Method. It requires a price comparison. So this is the mother of all methods, because once you find a CUP, then you don't need to even look at the other methods. It is the closest comparison because it is actually comparing the prices of 2 products, and the assumption is that the underlying products are same or similar. Once you find this kind of comparison, then you don't need to do anything else. So it is the most preferred method, but it is also the most challenging method, because many a times, or rather most of the times, you will not find a good comparable or which is close enough. And maybe even if you find, then maybe you cannot make a good adjustment to the price to find out that if we were to remove differences, then what should have been the number. So we generally see this being applied in products where you get a comparable within the same entity, or maybe on some stock exchange or some commodity market, or say maybe there are price lists which are published, or there are rate cards which are published that for this resource I will bill at X rate for per hour or for per day or for per month. So if you have a rate which is fixed with a group entity as well as a third party for the same level of resource, maybe that could be a CUP. Royalty rates is somewhere where we apply the CUP method. So we look at deals. So for example, there is brand licensing. So we will look at brand licensing rates in the open market. Financing terms, so interest, what should be the rate of interest? One, I said product similarity. Second is the time gap between the price determination of the comparable and the tested party should not be very far off, because if it is a dynamic market where the prices keep changing, then maybe CUP is not the right method to apply. So timing is also very important when you are looking at the CUP method. The resale price method, it is the method where you which is applied when there is, say for example, I will take a Microsoft India. So say Microsoft India is distributing Microsoft US licenses in India, okay? It is doing, pardon me, I'm not on the facts of the particular case, but it is just to give you a sense. So maybe Microsoft licensing limited duty is to identify the entities which need these licenses, bulk licenses. So maybe as an individual, you and I can go to a store and buy this license, go online and buy this license. But larger organizations where you need, bulk of licenses to be procured at one go, and also you need to inbuild all of those discounts, then you will go to the Microsoft authorized dealer, you will go to Microsoft India itself, do a deal with them that I need 1 lakh licenses, 10,000 licenses, what will be the price for it? So maintaining the brand value in India, maintaining the brand relationship in India, maintaining, educating the Indian customers about what are the various developments that the product is imbibing into it. So basically you are not touching the product per se, but, and you are not making much value addition to the product per se, but you are largely more of a seller only. Okay. So if the function is that simple or simpler and not too much of value addition is being done by the Indian distributor, then the benchmarking is done with respect to the gross margin. So what you will do is you will try to find out what is the margin that is being earned in similar third party cases. Say in our case, we find out that a similar distributor is earning say 25% on sales as gross profit margin. Then what Microsoft India will do, say if it realizes 100 from the end customer in India, it will have to, under the TP methods, retain 25% in India. And what it can pay to Microsoft US is at best 75 rupees or something which is lower than 75 rupees, but not something which is higher than 75 rupees. So this is an indirect way of determining the price of the transaction by adopting the profit that should be applied. So I've already discussed the other features, so I will not discuss it here. But wherever you find that there is value addition being done by India, say for example, instead of Microsoft, now I will say that there is LG. Or say there is a Sony India, and you see that Sony India is doing a lot of advertising, lot of brand value enhancement. Say for example, so in that case, it is not a simple distributor, but it is adding value to the brand value, to the brand, and also kind of creating an enhanced market. So it is not a simple buyer seller, not a simple distributor. And maybe in that facts, once you drill down to specifics, you may find that GP margin is not the right parameter and maybe resale price method will not apply. Cost plus method is generally applied, and I've seen very, very, very few cases of this being applied, mainly because we don't get GP margin in case of service manufacturing entities or service companies. They generally operate on a net margin basis. So if you have an Indian manufacturer who's selling goods, semi-finished goods to its German associated enterprise, and that company in turn is using it in its, say for example, it is manufacturing some machinery and it is getting some semi-finished products from the Indian entity, incorporating them in the larger machinery and then selling that machinery globally, then in that case the Indian manufacturer could be compensated on a cost plus basis. I'm talking of GP margin over here, gross profit margin. So if in independent cases, once you find out all the comparables and you are able to get the GP data for those comparables, you find out those comparables are running 35% margin, then the Indian manufacturer ought to earn nothing less than 35%. You can earn a 40%, 45%, 70%, whatever you want to value at, but nothing below a 35%. Here again, far similarity, very important. And most important, getting the data, which we have seen is a big challenge. This is one of the most, or rather I should say the most complicated method. I have seen it used very, very sparingly because of the complications it involves. So till now, whatever we discussed and later on also the other methods that we'll discuss, you are always evaluating one particular leg of the transaction or one particular transaction. Because it is a separate transaction, you can evaluate it separately. You have comparables to evaluate it. But there are sometimes cases where the participating entities are not that simple. So you don't have a very clean case that India is a simple entity, India is not doing value add, or foreign entity is not doing value add, and India is only doing all the value addition. Sometimes you find that there is a startup, okay, which is where the half of the brain is sitting in India, half of the brain is a US resident. They were friends earlier. They studied together, but one of them wants to continue to operate out of India and the other wants to continue to operate out of US. And they are co-developing a product, say, for example, and the product kicks off. And however they tap the sales is another thing. But you have IP or you have brand or you have intangibles or you have intelligence or technology or whatever is the IP and the functions. Both the people are involved fully into making the business successful. Then in that case, one cannot be remunerated using some X percentage. they both will ask for a share in the profits and something similar will happen over here. So here, depending on the relative contributions done by both of them or three or more, whoever is there, you will split the ultimate pie of the profit between all of the ultimate profit between all of them. And this is a very difficult method because there's a lot of subjectivity involved. You have to find out what are all the value drivers, who's contributing what to the value chain, how much is the contribution, which is all, it is anybody's guess. And in fact, we have done interviews to find out what are the value drivers. And what used to happen is the production guy would say that I am the most important person. The brand guy would say, nahi, nahi, production to ordinary process hai, machine hi to chalani hai. It is I who's important. Or the distribution guy will say that if I don't tap my network, then you will not be able to sell the product. So you may manufacture whatever, but I am most important. So within the same organization, there is a perceived difference in terms of what is the value. So there are ways to overcome this challenge also. But what I'm trying to say is that if in the same organization, there is so much of difference of opinion in terms of the value drivers, imagine how difficult it will be to explain it to the tax office. Also, you need to draw up financial books. You have to open up end-to-end books of accounts to the tax office. There should be some similarity in accounting principles. You find the years are different. Indian books closing in March, foreign books closing in December. So, and accounting policies are different. Someone is following IFRS, Indian entity is following IGAAP. So it's a lot tougher. I'm not saying it is impossible to implement. Yes, but it is a lot more tougher when you implement this method. This is the favorite method because it kind of overcomes all the other challenges imposed by the other method. So what you do over here is you do a margin analysis on a net level. Almost across the world, this is the most widely used method. The name may be slightly different outside, but the moot point here is that you are comparing margins, and once the tested party's margin is more than that of comparables, then the transaction is said to be meet at arm's length. What we can also do in TNMM is that if you have a bunch of transactions which are interrelated, so say for example, you are a manufacturing entity and you are trying to benchmark the sale price of the product, okay? And by the way, you have also paid a royalty for the process you've taken from the foreign entity. And by the way, you are also paying royalty for the brand name to another group entity. Because these transactions are so interlinked, and I'm assuming for a moment that you are not able to justify it using the CUP method. Ideally, the right approach is each transaction has to be looked at separately, but sometimes it is very difficult to find a proper comparable. And sometimes the value of the transaction is so small, I'm talking more practical than technical over here, that the value is so small that the cost of compliance would be higher. So say, for example, you've paid 50,000 as brand royalty. But the consultant says, I will charge 1 lakh rupees for benchmarking this transaction. I'm just giving an example. So it just doesn't make sense. Then what you would rather do is you would aggregate all of these transactions and you would say that we will use TNMM as the basis. So there has to be some, and the OECD also recognizes this, and some cases the courts have also, I don't have the names handy with me, but if it makes sense, if it is ticking the box as to why aggregation is possible can be done, then in that case, you can have a combined approach where you benchmark 3 or 4 transactions together using the TNMM approach. Because here, you will be benchmarking either the entity or that particular segment. Whatever is the profit derived from that segment will be tested against what comparables are earning. If the segment is earning more than the comparables margin, then you are home. There are also, depending on whether your transaction is on the cost side or on the revenue side, you will have to decide which is the side you need to test. You always test the opposite side. So say, for example, you are a distributor. Your transaction is purchase of goods. Your sales side is the independent side, where you are getting revenues from an independent party. So your profit level indicator will be return on sales. That is the independent side. Let's take an IT company. So say, let's say Infosys, I'm just giving an example. Let's say Infosys India is a contract manufacturer, say for Infosys UK, if that example can be used. And Infosys India is generating revenue from Infosys UK. In that case, the transaction which is being tested is sitting on the revenue side for Infosys India. And what you will test is whether Infosys India is getting a cost plus margin, which is commensurate to what a third party is getting. So remember, the side on which your transaction is with the group entity, you have to test the opposite side. So if it's a revenue transaction sitting on the revenue side, you have to test the cost and vice versa. ENMM allows you to make adjustments. We will discuss that a little later. What I have done over here is try to give some practical insights of what do you look at when you are trying to identify, because when you open a database, you will see that there are thousands of companies. You will try to run a search on industry, on the relevant industry. So you will start filtering out. So this slide will be shared. So this is just this idea, you know, where financial data is not available for that particular year. Insufficient information is there. RPT is more than the identified threshold. So RPT is related party transaction. So as I discussed earlier, you cannot have a comparable which is having a lot of related party transactions. Okay, it should genuinely be a representative of the open market. So what is happening is, because there is no law in place or there is no guidance from the government in terms of what should be the related party threshold, more often than not, what we do is we use that 26% threshold as the benchmark. And we say that if you have an entity with transactions more than 25% with related party on either sides of the profit and loss, maybe it could be an expense or an income side. If those expenses and income cross more than 25% of the turnover of that company, then we exclude that. That is a reject for us, because then what we say is that the P&L or the operating result of that company is not an independent one. It is heavily influenced by related party transactions. Now, this is not cast in stone. No, it's some courts have held that 15% is the threshold. In fact, I read one ruling quite some time back where even 1% was not acceptable. That was a really extreme case. But by and large, we have seen the courts accepting 25%. And if you want to do 20, if you have a very good set, you can go as below as 15% also. Persistent loss makers not always applied. But yeah, if you are, it depends on the business cycle and at the phase at which you are, and the industry also. So if that persistent loss maker is an aberration, then you will exclude it. But if that industry generally is grappling, then you cannot. If you are doing a benchmarking report for the hotel industry in COVID times, of course, all loss makers will be your comparable. The idea here is, and I'm not talking of loss for a year, where you have companies who are persistently making losses and some of them are making really absurd losses. So that cannot be the correct benchmark. So that ideally, if all 3 years the company is a loss-making company, generally, to be on the side of caution, we would exclude. But if you feel that the facts are similar, you can still keep them. Then we go to qualitative filters, get into specifics. Like I gave the car example earlier, just you cannot compare. When you are doing TNMM, yes, of course you can. But here again, sometimes the margins for luxury cars is very different as compared to the margins for the regular versions. So it's all industry driven. It is all driven by the practices. It is driven by perceptions as to, I have to retain this margin to be in this field or, you know, to cater to this segment of the market. So in that cases, you have to drill down to specifics. You have to understand what is the model. A commission agent and a distributor cannot be compared. One is operating, is getting a service charge, and the other is getting a return on sales. Say, for example, a broker is getting brokerage and an investment advisor may just get a fixed fee. So you have to understand how the compensation model works in the case of your client versus the in other industry players. There are economic adjustments which are permitted. I will not spend too much of time because I have lots more to cover. The sixth method is the method which is, it's not a method benchmarking per se, but it is an enabling provision. So it is an option given to the taxpayer as well as the tax office that if you cannot benchmark, you don't get adequate comparables, then you can fall back on any other method that a third party would have used to price the transaction in the given circumstances and considering all of the facts. So it was a good move by the government when it came in 2012. And you will see this being used more often where you are having transactions pertaining to intangibles or there is business transfer happening. How do you price this transaction? It is so difficult to price the intangible. More often than not, you will go to a valuer and say that please value. So what he'll do is he'll draw up the DCF We will see if I can find a market comparable. So, but those are all, that valuation report is not a real transaction, right? It is something that this brand should earn over a period of time. So the other method enables you to use something which is not really a transaction. It is something that could have been a transaction or some method of arriving at the price of the transaction. So this is an, more often than not, where you struggle, where you don't find any other benchmark, then maybe you can resort to this method. The ICAI guidance note has given a lot of examples. You can get a third party quotation. You can get a valuation report. There is a tender bid document. Documents which are used in negotiation. Standard rate cards can be used as a under other method. I will just spend 2 minutes here. So earlier the way benchmarking was done, and let's take TNMM as an example, but in principle it applies to the others also. Is say, for example, you're making a TP study report for March 21, then the tax office allowed you to use March 21 data only. Okay. And you could use March 19 and March 20 data only if you were able to prove that those 2 years' data had an effect on the pricing. Now, there was a lot of hue and cry because when you are making the TP study report sitting in the month of October, the databases are not updated. So many comparables have not filed their annual reports. It is practically impossible to get a healthy set. So maybe, you know, I have seen cases where out of 20 companies, we used to find data only for two companies if we did the search early in the day. Because the filings have not been done with the MCA, because that is the source of data compilation by the databases. There was a lot of representation. Also, they said that 1 year data is not a representative of the true margin. You should take a period of 3 years because that is also the global practice. So the Indian government amended the rules and now you can use 3 years data, but you can use 3 years data only in the case of RPM, CPM and TNMM. So only these three profit methods allow you to use prior 2 years data. The other methods, you have to use data pertaining to that relevant year only. How you do it is, you have to see whether that company is a comparable, say for March 21. If it is not a comparable, please reject it outright. Don't waste your time on it. But if it is, you don't get March 21 data, the law allows you to look at March 20 data. If you find that it is a comparable for basis March 20 data, you keep it as a comparable in your data set. So now you have identified a comparable. The next step is to do the margin calculation. What the law says is, once you have identified a company as a comparable, you can use 3 years weighted average margin. I will show an example in the later slide. Now, what happens here is there is a challenge because there are powers given to the assessing officer to consider the data which is available when he is doing the transfer pricing scrutiny. So the TPO is not bound to use only the data that is there in your TP study report. He will look at data which is available maybe 1 year down the line when he is doing the transfer pricing audit. So say, for example, this comparable which you took basis March 20 data, when you're sitting in front of the TPO 1 year after filing the tax, your TP report, the TPO says, abhi to is company ka March 21 ka data available hai. I will look at it whether it is a comparable or not. And suddenly he finds that this very good comparable of yours, which is earning this 2%, 3% margin, is a reject because that company is liquidated, has gone into another business, it is not providing data, it has not done filings for whatsoever reason, it is a reject. So this company is a reject. So although you did the right thing at the TP study stage, but because the law is worded such, the TPO has the powers to remove that as a comparable. Further, the TPO also has powers to add comparables. If during the TP audit stage, he finds that there are more comparables which are available, he can definitely add that to your set. One important aspect that comes from this is, please follow sensible filters, sensible methods and conclusions when you are adding a comparable to your data set. More often than not, the way we have seen the tax office defend its set is, as SE ne bhi, SE hi company ko comparable liya hai. So basically what they try to say, we are doing what the SSE has done. How different are we from what the SSE has done? So just don't do a half-picked job. Apply your mind properly, document it properly, come to the right conclusions. Just because one comparable has a good margin or two or three of them have very low margins and they will bring down the average margin, don't use them. If they are not satisfying all the filters, they are not satisfying the parameters, if it is qualitatively not a comparable, because it will come to haunt you at a later stage. The range concept. So there are two concepts over here. One is the older concept, which is still there. I'm calling it old because it has been in place for a very long time. So arm's length is very difficult because it is one data point. When you talk of ALP, it is one data point, and it is not always possible to satisfy price point per se. So the law allows you flexibility to use a range. So say, for example, you are selling your product for say 100 rupees. Okay. The law allows you that your price could be, your arm's length price could fall in the range of 3% plus or minus from this 100 rupee. So your arm's length price could be either 90, it could be anywhere, any data point between 97 rupees to 103 rupees. Okay. So once you have done your arm's length analysis, you find out that the comparables margin or the comparables price is 102. So although you have earned 100, which is lesser than 102, still because the number falls between 100 and 103, you are at arm's length. Okay. Now let's take a scenario where the arm's length is not 102, but 104. Then the adjustment will not be 104 minus 103. It is not where the range closes. No, it is the difference between the arm's length price and the transaction price. So here the transfer pricing adjustment will be 104 minus 100. So once you are out of the range, then that range becomes irrelevant. Only the range is important to see if you fall and then you are in the safe zone. So it's like a safe zone. But once you are outside the safe zone, then the full adjustment will happen. This range is 1% in case of wholesale business. The new concept, which is in line with a lot of representations made, and this is in line with what is followed globally also, and it was, we were very happy when it came in. So it is applicable again in the case of the three profit methods, and only in the case of cup also they allow this. So the price that we were discussing, it is applicable only if you have more than six comparables. Okay. And the way you do it is, and I have an example later, we will discuss it. Your range is sitting between the 35th percentile data point to the 65th percentile data point of the set, which we'll see later. So globally, we see the interquartile range, what we call it, and that sits between 25th percentage to 75th percentage. So while the government has given the benefit of the range concept, it is a slightly narrower range as compared to the global practice. But still, it is better than the 3%, I must say. I have seen a lot of relief coming out of application of the range concept. If you don't fit in the range, then the median of that of the set will be considered to be the arm's length price, and adjustment will happen accordingly. Where there is a transaction which does not qualify for the range, so say you have less than six comparables, or you are using say some other method, in that case you will apply the old range concept. This is a summary of the use of multiple data versus the range concept. So we've already discussed this, just a snapshot, and you can refer to it when the slide is shared with you. This example is sitting in the rule 10CA itself. I have just copied it from there because it is very simple to understand, very well presented. In fact, we were surprised when it was when it came out, because we've always seen so much of theory and so much of text as to how things are to be done, but pleasantly, when this rule came out, it came out with an example guiding the taxpayer how this regulation has to be applied. I'll just take one as an example. So in case of company A, OC is the operating cost, OP is the operating margin. So for year one, the numbers are the year two, year three. When you aggregate the operating profits across the 3 years, the total is 57. When you aggregate the operating cost across the 3 years, the total is 475. So your weighted average, so there are no weights applied. It's 1:1:1. But we call it weighted average because the operating cost is considered as the base. So the operating margin for that particular company across 3 years is 12%. Okay. You will do this exercise for all the seven companies. I'm assuming that there are seven companies which are thrown up. Once you do it, you will arrange the set in ascending order, is what is table two down below. And you will give data places. So data place 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and you will put the values against them. The 35th percentile is computed as 7. That is your total number of comparables into 0.35 or 35%. that is 2.45. You will round it off to 3 as per the rules. In the third place, you find that the margin is 8.2%. So this is your lower range. Similarly, the higher range is 10.57. And your median is the fourth data point, which is 9%. So if your company is, say, earning a margin anywhere between 8.2% to 10.57%, you are in the safe zone. Okay. If your company is, say, earning 8.3%, it is okay. I'm on the lower side now because we are looking at an income side of things. So even if you are at 8.2, you are okay. But if you are at, say, 8%, you are outside the range. In that case, the adjustment will be 9% minus 8%. So 1% of income addition will be done in the hands of the taxpayer. This example is there in the rules. The same example is there. You can look at it and you can absorb it better once you do it. There is a specific mechanism provided which you should read. We saw benchmarking, how you do the benchmarking. You will find out the comparable, so on and so forth. There are some alternates available which you can explore. So when the taxpayer doesn't want to do all of this headache, you know, the transaction value is small. It doesn't want to litigate. There are options given, again, in line with global practices. There are safe harbor rules which are in place. It is not. So these are, I'll go to the next slide to explain it better. So the government has, and this is only, these are only some of the safe harbor margins which have been given by the government. This is not the entire list. You should go through the rules. So the government identified a lot of sectors where a lot of litigation was happening, a lot of representation was happening. And what it said is, okay, you don't want to litigate it. What you do, you pay me X percentage, okay, which could be slightly higher than the arm's length price. And if I find that you are satisfying the conditions which are given in the safe harbor rules, I will accept that price as it is. And we will not, neither will you litigate it further, neither will I do scrutiny of your books of accounts. So it's like a give and take between the assessee and the tax office. So say, for example, you're providing software development services and you have to see the definition of software development, which is given in the safe harbor rules. If you are satisfying that definition and your top line is not more than, say, 100 crore, then you can offer income basis the 17% margin. You don't need to undertake this whole comparability analysis. Make an application to the AO, say, I want to opt for safe harbor rules. File it before the due date of the return of income. The AO has been given time of around 2 months to look at your application. And if he doesn't revert, then it is considered to be as accepted. So it is a fast time-bound process. He cannot keep you hanging. So you have some certainty that, okay, if I offer 17% cost plus 17% to tax, then I am home. I don't have an issue over here. So you should read the provisions carefully because there are conditions. Say, for example, software development is defined. You have to see whether you fit in the definition. Also, this benefit is only available till your turnover is up to 200 crore. If you are a very large company, you cannot resort to safe harbor rules. Say, for example, here there are turnover restrictions. In case of, say, export of core auto components, there is no restriction of turnover. There is only the margin which is given. Then in the case of provision of KPO services, they look at what is your employee cost ratio, and basis that the margins keep changing. So the more intense the employee function is, the more will be the margin that the government will ask for. One change which has been brought out in this provision, and a good one, welcome one, is the concept of low value adding services. So where there is not much value addition done, there are rudimentary accounting functions, or say some kind of support services which are provided. These are back office functions. These are not really contributing on the revenue side of things. And the cost plus, if it's at cost, very good. Even if it is up to cost plus 5%, it is okay. If the transaction value does not exceed 10 crore, you can opt for the safe harbor. There are conditions given which you should go through. If you satisfy those conditions, then a lot of litigation on intra-group services can be cut down, because we have seen very often that there is a challenge and the tax office simply says that the arm's length price of the transaction is zero. One thing important over here is safe harbor is not arm's length price. So maybe the Indian entity is all gung-ho about applying it or very happy, but the foreign entity may not be happy about the fact, because in its country, it will not get a deduction for the difference between the arm's length price and the safe harbor. So globally, it is a known fact. Safe harbor does not mean arm's length price. So when you evaluate these options, you have to also see it from the foreign entity's point of view. The other option, a little more complicated option, a little more expensive option, but a very useful one, I must say, if you have the appetite for it, is going in for an APA. It is a contract which the company does with the CBDT. Basically, you pre-agree that this is the margin for the kind of services that I render, for the products that I sell, or for the distribution activities that I, whatever be the case. It gives certainty to the taxpayer. So you can sign a deal for 5 years at one time. It can be renewed again for 5 years at once it comes up for renewal. You also have option of rollback. So you can cover the past years also. So past 4 years. So at any point of time, if you decide to go in for an option, if you have litigation, then you can cover 9 years at one go. It is completely driven by negotiations. You can opt out of it if you find that the discussions are not going in the right direction. Actually, we've seen the APA authorities are very pragmatic, and they actually get into the details of things. They will come for a site visit. So it's a very welcome, what should I say, move by the government. And the way the program is conducted is also very good. Only that there is a lot of cases which have piled up, and COVID made things only worse. But we hope to see soon a lot of movement there. But it's a brilliant option if you don't want to litigate endlessly. You have an option to, the government can cancel the APA also if they find that you've made misrepresentation. There are compliances which I'm not discussing because we don't have much time. Secondary adjustment. So at a conceptual level, without getting into very much too much of details. So whenever you have a primary adjustment, which is for a year after AY 17-18, and the value is crossing 1 crore, then you have to basically get monies into India. So secondary adjustment is nothing but the need to repatriate funds into India. So earlier, what used to happen is people used to just offer their transfer pricing adjustment to tax. So maybe when the TPO is doing the adjustment, or where you are doing a voluntary adjustment, or there is an APA being signed. So APAs used to insist on getting the monies in India, and taking cue from that and also global practices for secondary adjustment, India decided to implement this. So wherever there is an enhancement of income due to transfer pricing, then it is not sufficient that you only offer that income to tax. You also have to get the monies into India. There are 5 scenarios in which you may have to offer income. One is where you suo moto say that, you know, your transaction value is not at arm's length, and I'll offer additional income. In the other case, the tax office will make an adjustment. You accept it. You don't litigate it. Okay. Or where till the final stage, you lost it. And now you say, okay, I don't want to litigate it further. Or maybe options are not open to you, and you have to accept the additional price. Or there is a additional price margin that you've agreed with the APA authorities. Or you apply for a safe harbor, and maybe your transaction is at 14%, but safe harbor is at 17%. So that 3% you have to get into India, or as a result of MAP. So here, the timeline given is 90 days broadly from the event. So there are events which are defined. What happened is the 90 days for an AP applicable versus for a return of income. So just you will have to read the specifics there. But broadly, if you don't get the monies in 90 days, then interest is counted. If it is an Indian rupee denominated transaction, the interest is MCLR, marginal cost of lending, plus 3.25% and or 325 basis points. And in the case of a foreign currency transaction, it is 6-month LIBOR plus 300 basis points. So, and this will continue in perpetuity till you get the monies into India. So what was happening is there was a lot of representation being made by the taxpayer community that my AE has liquidated. My AE has shut down, it doesn't have the money, or now I have been taken over by some other group. This transaction happened 4 years back. How do you expect me to trace? And how do you expect the other entity to pay me? So what the government allows you is that, say, for example, you are in the same group, and that particular associated enterprise cannot pay you the money, then you can ask some other associated enterprise, provided it is sitting outside India, to send the money to you. So basically, money should come from outside India to inside India. And say you have changed the group, that you have no longer any relation with that associated enterprise or that group per se, then there is one more option given to the taxpayer that, okay, you cannot get the monies. So whatever is the secondary adjustment, you pay a one-time tax of 18% on that adjustment and plus SN surcharge, and the matter will be closed for you. So the running interest meter will stop when you make these payments. Otherwise, it is considered to be a loan in perpetuity till such time that you repatriate the monies into India. this is kind of a summary. I will not spend time because I've already spoken about it. It just gives the entire chart of what you need to do, starting from collating macro level data of the company and the entity, all the way to finding comparables. If you don't find comparables, you have to repeat the process. You may have to change the method. So it's an evolving, it's nothing is cast in stone in TP. Even if a method was applicable in the earlier year, it may not be applicable in this current year because you are not getting the right set of comparables. So it's like a cycle. It moves depending on what is available with the client and with the in the third party databases. After doing all of this, you determine the arm's length price, or you opt for safe harbor, or you apply the APM margin. If not, then you have to make adjustments to your income and also start the process for getting the monies into India. There are some global developments. So as I said earlier, in the India TP regulations are driven a lot by what has been prescribed by the OECD. And more you will see that India, if you read or you've been observing in the past, India is very, very active on the international platform. So India, China are one of the most active participants. Because they saw that they had a lot to lose if they simply followed the way the developed countries were giving taxing rights. So India and China are kind of the ones who keep fighting for their rights, and it's a good thing for us. So while India is not a participant or is not a member country of OECD, its thoughts have a lot of place and in the OECD forum. And is respected. India is a very respected member. Also, India has been one of the fastest adapters of whatever action plans the OECD has rolled out in the recent past. In fact, this entire discussion about equalization levy, India was one of the first countries to implement equalization levy after the concept was brought about by OECD when it was trying to address the issues of digital taxation. So there is much more which is happening. I've been just focusing on the critical ones. The first one is Action Plan 4. Action Plan 4 is nothing but thin capitalization regulations, which try to curtail the malpractices followed by some groups to have a very leveraged company or to have a very debt-heavy company, have a very skewed equity-debt ratio to try and extract monies out of a country by way of interest. So this has been in place globally. So in other parts, you may find, you know, there are debt ratios which are prescribed or there are some formulas which are given. So India has adopted Section 94B. I will go to that section a little later. There is a very big docket, Action Plan 8 to 10. It focuses on, and it is the foundation or the basis on which the transfer pricing guidelines have been written. It talks about how you will align substance and you will map the value creation activities, and that is the basis for determining the transfer price or the arm's length price. When the guidelines were out, it also gave guidance in terms of how do you look at intangibles. A very detailed guidance was given, and the term DEMPI was, we were introduced to the concept of DEMPI. DEMPI is abbreviation of the term of the process that you look at when you are looking at intangibles value creation. So when you are looking at IP, you will see who is the developer, D, who is enhancing the IP, E, who is maintaining the IP, M, who is protecting the IP, P, and who is exploiting the IP. Once you go through the entire value chain and there is a lot of guidance given, good guidance given, you can follow that. And then you can determine what is the arm's length price and who in the value chain should get what out of the exploitation proceeds of that particular IP. A lot of emphasis there is on the function. The person who's absorbing the risk or the person who's undertaking functions is the one who's supreme in that value chain. Then there is Action Plan 13. It kind of redid the entire way documentation is looked at in the world of transfer pricing. There are a few slides there which we will discuss. So till now, what we were discussing is the transfer pricing study report. OECD Action Plan 13 introduced a three-tier approach to documentation, which we will discuss in the later slide. So these are the three critical action plans which are relevant for our discussion today. The first one, thin capitalization. So the idea is, and I've already discussed it, not much over it, is but is that you cannot have a situation where you have such a skewed debt equity ratio that it starts looking fishy. So you just cannot, you know, give 100 rupees of equity and have 10 crores worth of debt and try to extract. So everyone knows dividend is taxable, or you have to do a lot of compliances before you declare dividend. There is double level of taxation because the company will also pay tax and then the shareholders will pay tax. So why not just pay interest? You know, that's a very good way of doing things. But to stop these kind of malpractices, this section was introduced. The main point here is the deduction that is available to the Indian entity is capped at 30% of the EBITDA. Okay. So whatever is the excess expenditure over 30% of EBITDA is disallowed for that particular financial year. But you can claim a deduction of that expense in the later years. Do read the section. For want of time, I will not get into details. Debt is very widely defined. The term guarantee is very widely defined. So you may not get funds from your associated enterprise. You may get it from a third party. But if your AE has guaranteed it, it will still fall under the purview of the section. I have given one example over here. So say the EBITDA of the entity, Indian company, is say 1,000. In scenario one, that is your second column, the interest which you have paid is 200. 30% of your EBITDA is 300. So the disallowance, which is lesser of the interest expenditure or 30% of EBITDA, is nil. So you will get a complete deduction of 200 rupees. Nothing is disallowed. So you are home. Let's take a scenario where your interest is 400, what you have paid. And this interest payment could be to a third party also. Okay. This interest of 400 is a general interest paid. It is not only to the associated enterprise. But if you have any element of interest paid to an associated enterprise, 94B will kick in. So your 30% of EBITDA is 300. Your interest, which is interest less 30% of EBITDA, is 100. So 400 minus 300. So what you have paid excess in this year is rupees 100, which will be disallowed in this current year. And you will be allowed an interest deduction of only 300. Which is, that is the cap at of 30% of EBITDA. This 100 you can carry forward in your books, okay? And you can claim it as a deduction. When I'm saying books, I'm saying tax, for tax purposes. You can claim a deduction for this in the subsequent 8 years, okay? But every year you will have to do this exercise. So first you will see, you will do this math and see whether you are exhausting these limits. Only if there is a limit still left, you will set off part of, so the way you do business loss absorption, set off, something similar will be done for interest as well. It is not applicable to banking companies, so, but for every other sector, it is, you have to do this calculation. What are the compliances? I still have 15 minutes. Okay. I spoke of the three-tier documentation. So there is the local file. I am using these terms. These terms are coming out of the OECD guidelines, and now even you see a lot of the usage in India as well. So local file is nothing but your 92D documentation or the TP study report, as we call it, that we discussed. Over and above that, you need to, so the TP study report is documenting the process that we discussed in the earlier slides, where you will discuss details about your client, the details about the parent company, the details about the industry overview which is impacting your client, details of the specific transactions which the client undertook, what is the FAR analysis of those transactions, what is the arm's length price of those transactions. So it is the objective of a local file or a TP study report is to benchmark the transactions which are before you for that particular financial year. Okay. So it is a very micro level analysis. And a very specific analysis, which is restricted to that particular entity. Now, what is a master file? You will ask, how different is it from a TP study report? A master file is a more generic document and it is made at a group level. I will, in the subsequent slide, show you what all is covered there. It is not restricted to particular transactions undertaken during a financial year. Okay. It is more of a macro level view. It's a bird's eye view of what the group does. Who are all the participants in the group? What are their, what is their business, so on and so forth. The last, and master file is not applicable to everyone. We'll discuss the thresholds later. And the last is the country by country report. This is a complicated piece of document. It is easy Excel to see, but compiling it is a challenge. And there is a lot of data that is made available. This is at a group level. And this is applicable only to entities which having a group turnover of more than 750 million euros. So it is not, it may not be applicable to your client's case if it is a smaller group. If so a very small group maybe only has to do a TP study compliance. A slightly larger group will have to do a master file compliance, and a much larger group, depending on where you are satisfying the thresholds, will have to do even a CBCR or a country by country report. I have simply put the provisions down. So every SSE who is having an international transaction, you have to maintain TP study. I'm not looking at the COVID timelines, but generally you have to file it by 31st October of the relevant assessment year. You have to file the Form 3CV by that date. And by that, so basically the TP study is the foundation for the Form 3CV or the accountant's report. The auditor will not or should not sign off till he sees the TP study report, basis which he issues the Form 3CV, which is uploaded online. So the due date of that is 31st October, and accordingly the TP study has to be in place by that date. Master file, we'll discuss timelines later, and if applicable, you have to comply. CBCR, we'll discuss timelines later. That is another compliance that needs to be done. Now, what is TP study report, which I just spoke of, or the local file? This is all that you have to mandatorily document in the TP study report. It is giving the government an end-to-end perspective, starting from the group to the transaction level data to the arm's length price that the taxpayer has maintained. So ownership details, who is owning the Indian entity, what is the group org chart, what is the group ownership chart, how are you associated with the other enterprise, who you are transacting with. So you have to give the details. You don't have to give details of all the entities. You have to give details only of the entities that you have transacted with. Okay, that is relevant. And how are they owned? Maybe give details of even that entity. You have to give the details of the associated enterprises in terms of what is the legal status. Is it a LLP? Is it a LLC? Is it a company? Is it an individual? Who is it? Where is it based? Is it a resident of America? Is it a resident of US, of Cyprus, Netherlands, Singapore? So those kind of details. You have to give the industry overview, and you have to focus on the industry that is relevant to the transactions. So say, for example, your client is into two streams of business. It is into manufacturing business, and it is into, say, distribution also. The international transactions have happened in the manufacturing segment. Then your industry overview should be focused more on the products your client is dealing with in the manufacturing segment or the manufacturing industry relevant to that product. Don't go abstract. The idea is how are those industry parameters or economic conditions affecting your client is what you need to document here. You have to document what are the nature and terms of the international transaction. What is the deal between the two parties? Say it is a cost plus 15 arrangement, you will have to mention over there. Or it is a product which will be sold at cost plus 5%, or it is a hourly rate of $25 per whatever. So those are the terms. I'm just talking of pricing points. You will have to discuss the other terms also in terms of who has to do what as per the agreement. Then you will document the FAR analysis, which we spoke of. And FAR is for both the entities. More often than not, I've seen people only writing India ne ye kiya, India ne ye kiya. They completely forget to mention what the overseas entity is doing, or vice versa. Or the FAR is so thin that we can barely make sense out of it. I've seen very skewed reports also. It is not helping, mind you. In the earlier years, maybe because the law was new, courts, you got away with it and courts were also sympathetic. But today, that is not the case, especially because you have special forums like the DRP, or there are special CITs who focus on international transactions, international tax and transfer pricing. And there are ITAT benches which focus on international tax and transfer pricing. So you can't take them for a ride. Please ensure that you do a good job over here. Then you have to capture an arm's length analysis over here. You have to give the market analysis if there is something that is relevant. Otherwise, we skip it at times because it is too macro to affect the company, the company's pricing points. What are the methods you've applied? And till the last mile, that how did you determine the arm's length price? So these are all the mandatory things that you have to form. But when you put all of this together, so you will not find the term TP study report in the law. If you do a search, you will not find that word. It is a more colloquial word, or it is a jargon which is associated with the TP documentation. So all of these points, when you put together, the document that you create is the TP study report. So all of this guidance is given in Rule 10D. I would urge you to look at it. It gives you good stuff in terms of what you should start looking at when you are doing a putting together a TP study report. Now, as I discussed, master file is one notch above the local file, and master file is applicable only if the group's consolidated turnover is in excess of 500 crore, and the party who is filing the master file in India has international transactions of more than 50 crores, or if there are IP related transactions, intangible related transactions, maybe there is a purchase of an intangible or licensing fee paid for an intangible or sale of an intangible, which is in excess of 10 crore, the aggregate I'm saying, then in that case, even if you a lower threshold of 10 crore applies. What does the master file contain? It contains the organizational structure, basically starting from the parent to all the group entities. What is the business? What are the important value drivers, supply chain? So it may not be related at all to the transaction of your particular client, but it is the group's overview. What are the main products of the group, supply chains of those products? What are the intangible policies of the group? What are the financial policies of the group? What are the intangibles which are used in the group? Which are the important agreements which within the group? Say there's a cost allocation or a cost, there's a cost allocation policy, or there is a cash pooling arrangement in the group, or there are any APAs. So all of these pieces of information, it's a single document for the entire group, which is maintained, and it is more at a macro level. This is the guidance given by OECD. The Indian regulations have certain more points which have been prescribed, which you need to take care of. So as is, the document which is created outside India for master file may not suffice the 10DA regulations, the rule 10DA regulations. There are certain more aspects which I'll discuss in the next slide, which you need to incorporate to make it a Indian master file regulations compliant document. If you see the last bullet, there are certain additional points. I've just given some of them in a summarized format. So India requires that you list all your group entities and give the address of all the group entities, which is not an ask of the OECD. India has given a threshold of at least 10% of revenues or assets or profits. Any entity in the entire group which is contributing to one of these is above this threshold, you have to give details of that CE. CE means a constituent entity or a part of that group. It could be an entity resident in India or outside India. So you have to give a FAR analysis of those entities. You have to list all the entities which are engaged in the development and manufacture of intangibles, property along with their addresses. So this is not an ask of the OECD. Also names and addresses of the top 10 lenders, unrelated lenders. Now we were wondering why this was required, but this is the ask. So the master file that is created as per the OECD model, you will have to make tweaks to it to make it compliant with the Indian regulations. The filing requirements is in the second bullet point. So basically the form, form 3CB that we discussed earlier was an auditor's report or an accountant's report. It is filed by the, it is signed by the auditor. It's like an audit report. Form 3CA is filed by the company itself. Okay, there are two parts to it. The part A is the general part. This part A has to be filed by all taxpayers, whether you satisfy this threshold or not. Whether you satisfy the 50 crore or 10 crore threshold or not. But part B is to be filled by only those who satisfy the second criteria. Part B is nothing but these points that are discussed in the previous slide. The form has all of these points in the mentioned in part B, which you have to fill. So what you upload online and what you maintain in PDF is what we do. We create separate because at times there are character restrictions in the form itself. So there is also a parallel PDF document that is maintained to give the complete reporting. Say for example, the last bullet is on where you have say one group has say seven entities operating in India or 10 entities operating in India. So it is not important that all the 10 entities go and file the master file. Okay, it is of no use. So what you do is you will say that entity number four will be the designated entity for the entire group who will do the master file filing, will file the form 3CAA on behalf of the entire group. To do that, you have to first nominate that entity or designate that entity prior to the due date of filing the master file in form 3CAB. So the due date of filing the form 3CAA or the master file is the due date of filing the tax return, but this nomination has to be filed 30 days before, and after that, within 30 days, you can file the master file. CVCR we've discussed. So the Indian threshold closer to €750 million is 6,400 crore. So only groups with a consolidated turnover of more than 6,400 crore are affected by this regulation. It's a very interesting document. You should see it. For want of time, I will not be able to cover it, but it gives a complete, it's actually a country by country report. So wherever the group is present in whichever jurisdiction, each country wise, you have to give details of the revenue, the profits, your income tax, what are the accumulated earnings, number of employees. And thereafter, there is another table where you will give details of the entities which are operating in that jurisdiction. So there is a summary document and there is a it's a table where you have to give all of these details. So it is a input for the tax office to do a risk-based assessment of the taxpayers. This is not filed with the TPO. This is not filed with the AO. It is filed with the DG risk assessment, and it is to be maintained under strict confidentiality. India has made promises to the world that it will ensure that there is no data leakage on account of these filings, because that was one of the apprehensions that was there, why people were not comfortable. One is it is a lot of work to compile this data. Second, there is a lot of confidentiality which is associated with it. And so it has to be taken very strictly. So this is a tool for the government to find whether this entity should be picked up for scrutiny. So one of the tools, this is not exhaustive in that sense. So say, for example, you have, and this is really, it's a real case, not in one company, but in many, that you will have, you know, IP located in some jurisdiction where you will have only, say, 2 employees, 3 employees, 4 employees, and maybe their profile is not very handsome also. And you will see that the maximum profits are sitting in that country, okay? So when you do a profit by employee ratio, you will suddenly find that it is skewed to such a great extent that it is maybe 1,000 times, 2,000 times the employee profit ratio of any of some other company in the same group. So these are the tools that the government will use to, you know, pick up these cases, that this is a client or this is a group that I want to scrutinize and I want to get into details of. So CBCR itself is not very intelligent unless you start doing the ratio analysis using the tools to analyze the data, and that is what the government's intent to do. CBCR is a single document for the entire group, and the responsibility lies with the parent entity. The parent entity can appoint, so either the parent entity itself, the ultimate parent entity itself, does the CBCR, or it can appoint a surrogate parent, which is also known as a ARE or a alternate reporting entity. If the so what is the filing now? So we've learned who will maintain this document. Now let's see what are the filing requirements, assuming that your client group crosses the threshold of 6,400 crores. If you are an Indian headquartered company, when I mean that, I say that the ultimate parent company is sitting in India, or the surrogate parent is sitting in India who's responsible for CBCR filing, then you will file the CBCR within 12 months of the end of the accounting year. Okay. In other, or if you, India doesn't have a tax, doesn't have an agreement for information exchange, again, you will file it within 12 months. Or if India has been trying to source the CBCR from the foreign entity, from the foreign company, and there is not, the other party is not complying with it, it's called as a systemic failure. In that case, it's not systematic, sorry, there's a typo over here. It's called a systemic failure. And in that case, the Indian government will ask the Indian entity that now you file the CBCR because I'm not getting cooperation from your group entity. In that case, 6 months are given to the Indian entity to put together the CBCR or to source the CBCR and file it with the Indian government. Okay. In all other cases where there is an inbound company, what I mean by an inbound is that the parent is situated outside India or the surrogate is also situated outside India. In that case, the Indian entity has to only tell the tax officer who is the UPE or the ultimate parent entity who is responsible for CBCR. The Indian subsidiary of the foreign company does not need to file the CBCR. It only has to intimate. And then it will be the Indian government's responsibility to source the CBCR from that relevant country. Okay. Again, like in the case of master file, you can nominate one entity to do these filings. And there are various forms which are prescribed. I'll just spend 2 minutes here. I've talked enough on this topic, but I just cannot emphasize more on this because over the years in my career, and this is not my experience alone, I have seen it in many other cases also, my colleagues, the other practitioners, always the challenge has been a lack of documentation. The point is that we look at it more like a postmortem exercise. The year is over, chalo abhi TP study banate hain. And more often than not, we do not get the data which the client relied upon when he was doing the transaction itself. It is a big challenge. And then the people have exited, they have left the firm, unka data, unka emails access nahi mil raha hai, and system crash ho gaya for some other reason, or they find some documents, they don't find the balance, or a final kya deal hua tha, wo hamare paas hai nahi. A lot of practical challenges come across with even with the best intentioned people. I am not saying people are trying to skirt the law or they are trying to hide things, but even good intentioned people will suffer if you don't do things at the right point of time. So it is very important that you do documentation as a transaction on a real-time basis. And at least, I'm not asking everyone to put together a file, but at least start putting things in a folder. It's all IT-driven now. You have to just make a folder of whatever was relevant, or start putting the emails together, start printing, e-printing them, and whatever you want to do, create PDFs. So that when you are sitting with your auditor at the end, you're sitting with your consultant, or you yourself are representing yourself before the tax office, you only have to source those documents and make your case. And believe me, when you are able to prove that you did the right things, maybe the TPO will not listen to you because he has his targets. The DRP may or may not listen to you depending on what the perspective is. The CIT may or may not listen to you. But we have seen that the courts are generally very pragmatic and they take into account the efforts that have been put in by the taxpayers. So I say this and you will hear this from my mouth very often. Like Vidya Balan said that entertainment is what sells in the real world. In the real world, in the TP world, documentation and documentation is what sells. You cannot convince anybody otherwise. What is there in your head? What is there in your thought? What is there in the intentions and the mind of yours, your group entities? Doesn't matter. Till you are being able to prove it by way of concrete documentation, it will not sell through, believe me. So here, TP documentation, of course, there are regulations, there are penal implications. Karna to hai. But kitni achhi tarah se karna hai, how well do we do it? How well we are able to demonstrate how well written is the document? How well thought of is the document, and how have, so selection, exclusion, both have to be logical and rational is what we have to prove. You may face a TP adjustment in spite of all the best efforts. There is no guarantee that if your documentation is good, that there will not be a TP adjustment, but it saves you from a penalty risk, which is substantial. So please bear in mind, please take this very seriously because it will, even if you put in a lot of efforts at the year end, it will be of no avail if you are not able to source the right documents. Why Form 3CB and why I'm mentioning this? So Masterfile CBCR is there, but Form 3CB is closely connected to your TP documentation. It is like a proof to the tax office that yes, by the due date of filing the Form 3CB, my TP study was in place because your auditor is signing off on it. As a corollary, it is taken that if your Form 3CB is not filed on time, then maybe you have not done the documentation also on time. Okay, so please take the Form 3CB very seriously. Do the right reportings, do the right disclosures. It is the only way in which you report the transaction to the tax office. And we will see in the later slides what are the penal consequences of non-reporting. So TP study, Form 3CB, please take it very, very seriously. This is one favorite question of my clients. Just give me a minute. So this is one favorite question of my clients, foreign companies. Why should we do TP study? Indian entity kar to raha hai. And we've already benchmarked, we've done all the compliances that I will file the Form 3 CP, but don't ask me to prepare the TP study report. And this was, they're like, you're just trying to charge me additional fees, you know, by creating a TP study separately for the foreign company. And we tried, in the olden days, we used to spend a lot of time and effort on trying to reason with the clients. But as the penal provisions became stricter, and there is one ruling which I will discuss. I want to spend 2 minutes on that because it is very important. As we saw that the noose became tighter around the neck of foreign clients not doing TP documentation. Now the clients know that, you know, you have to do the TP study also. And just filing the Form 3CB will not be sufficient. So anybody who has an India sourced income, of course, you know that you have to offer it to tax. You will file a tax return. You will have to file a Form 3CB, that is mandatory. There are penalties for not filing, which we will discuss later. So what we advise the client is, even if you are for a moment taking a position that this income is not taxed. So say, for example, there is a foreign company earning some income from India. It is not in the nature of royalty, it is in the nature of business income. The client is taking a position that it is not taxable because it does not have a permanent establishment in India. Still, because it is a position which is to be tested. So permanent establishment is something which is tested on a year-on-year basis. The facts relevant to that year are seen. Basis that you have to arrive at a conclusion whether there is a permanent establishment or otherwise. Basis that you will do a FAR analysis, and basis that you will decide what is the margin that the Indian PE should be earning. And that basis all of this exercise, you will decide what is the income which the PE needs to offer to tax in India. So you cannot in your head say that, okay, there is no fee, no tax, I will not do TP compliance. Sorry, it doesn't work that way. It is very advisable, because for all you know, you may not succeed later, or for some reason you may give up on the claim. In that case, you will be taken aback with the amount of tax exposure, interest exposure, and penal exposure that you're sitting on for the non-compliance. Also, it's been quite some time that this ruling came out, but it is very important because it kind of it gave a lot of guidance in terms of the court's thinking of that how you will apply TP in the case of a foreign company. So this is a special bench ruling in the case of Instrumentarium. So what happened in this case was that there was a foreign company, Instrumentarium, which gave funds to the Indian company on interest-free basis. There was no interest charge. In such cases, typically the arguments that the group takes is that since there is no payout by the Indian entity, then there is no base erosion. Okay, because had the Indian entity paid out the interest, it would have claimed a deduction of say 30%. Whereas the foreign entity would have offered the same income to tax in India, say at 10%, 15%, whatever is the DTAA rate. So net-net, India would have lost money. So it is good that you are not paying any interest. The Indian entity is not paying any interest to the foreign company. So this is the principle of base erosion, or the argument of base erosion. And it still works. I'm not saying it still doesn't work. But what happened in the case of Instrumentarium, and that is why a factual analysis is required in every case, every year, for every transaction, is in this case, the Indian entity was a loss-making one. So in that particular year, it would not have paid any taxes. Whereas, or it would not have claimed any deduction because it was a loss-making entity. It would have just piled on to the business losses for set-off in the future years, had it paid the interest to the overseas counterpart. As against this, the overseas entity would have offered that income to tax in India because it would have received it. So what the court said, or what the special bench said, is that I will not do crystal ball gazing of the future. I am looking at the year in question. In the year in question, the foreign entity has saved the taxes by not earning interest from India. Okay. Future may Indian entity will set off the losses against potential profits that will arise at 30%. Don't give me that. There is no such provision in the law. We have to see the law for that particular financial year. And as per Indian regulations, you have to see the law for each of the two entities. You don't only have to see for one entity. So please look at the analysis for the non-residents also. You may have to adopt another method for the foreign company. depending on the facts of the case. The clause that or the terms we use that mirror kar lenge India ka report, it doesn't always work. Maybe it works in 70-80-90% of the cases, but there could be some cases still where you may miss the bus. So please pay attention. I have already overshot my time. I'll just CP scrutiny. I have discussed a lot, so I will not discuss this further. I will just discuss these points. These are the sensitive areas you need to take care of. So what triggers an alarm in the heads of the tax office is, these are some of the points. It's not an exhaustive list, but by and large, these are the points where you will fit in some shape and form and you are prone to challenge by the tax office. So say what markup you are getting is not commensurate to the work that you're doing. Say it's a service entity, it's getting only cost plus 15, whereas it should get a cost plus 40 maybe, or a cost plus 25, depending on what it is actually doing. Or say, for example, the Indian distributor is building a lot of brand, but it is still getting only a 2% margin, whereas it should be getting a 5% margin. Then the other transactions which are prone to challenge are where Indian entities are paying for use of IP. It could be technology IP, it could be a process IP royalty, it could be a brand royalty. It could be some kind of other intelligence which is being shared, some technical services. So the tax office keeps questioning, why did you pay this? Why do you need this at all? So those kind of questions come up. In case of outbound companies, so where there is an Indian parent with a subsidiary outside India or subsidiaries outside India, where the Indian entity is not charging anything for use of the Indian brand name outside India, or where Indian entity is providing free of cost services to the foreign company, say setup related, or where it is negotiating deals, it will send its marketing manager outside India to help them close the deal for which it will not charge. So where these free of cost services are happening, that is a challenge. Any kind of business restructuring, it will be challenged. They want to understand what has transpired and whether adequate compensation has been given, or where there are some functions shifting from one country to the other without any compensation or adequate compensation flowing along with it. The routine comparables related adjustments which are done, economic adjustments, working capital may not be allowed, risk adjustments may not be allowed. So those kind of disputes are there. One of the challenges which I spoke of earlier is very poor documentation and poor disclosures. That also comes to haunt you. TP penalties. So there is a penalty. This chart will be shared with you. It's also there in the rules. So what I want to emphasize here is on the 2% penalty. The rest you can see when you don't file master file, file lack of penalty. CBCR not filed, it's a daily penalty. When you don't file information, there is a 2% penalty. I want to focus more on 271AI1. So if you fail to maintain TP study or documentation, if you don't report a transaction, or if you furnish incorrect information, then straight away the penalty is equal to 2% of the value of the IT is international transaction and SDT is specified domestic transaction. So most important is report it. There is no, unless the client is doing something fishy, which then I would not like to work with that client. What is the downside in reporting the 2% or the transaction? Why are we unnecessarily taking the risk of 2% of penalty? Because you need to have really cogent reasons to give and good logical reasons to give for not reporting the transaction. You may file notes, you may take whatever positions that, this is the reason why TP should not apply. All that ability is given to you. You can keep litigating till the skies fall on us, but that is not the objective over here. What you need to do is at your end, please advise your client, your company, whoever it is, let's report it. How you report it, how you present it is a different thing, but please don't miss out on reporting. And one other penalty which I want to focus on over here is where there is an adjustment done, where there is a TP adjustment done, the penalties range from 50% or rather it is a 50% or a 200%. And whether you fall in 50% or 200% depends on whether you have reported the transaction and how good or bad is your documentation. Okay. So if you want to safeguard yourself, please report the transaction. Please maintain adequate documentation. And so even if worst case penalty is applied in your case, you are not able to justify or you're not able to succeed against the penalty proceedings, still the penalty will be capped to 50%. But if you are not good, if you've not done your homework, if you've not done your work properly, the penalty is equal to 200% of the tax. So what is the fun in doing this? So in some cases, maybe the transaction values are too small and you take a call of not doing a good job, but that cannot be the benchmark. In all other cases, I would strongly urge that you maintain a good TP study report. So all of these penalties which are tabulated here, they are all subject to 273B, that if you have a good reasonable cause for default, you are able to prove your bona fides. And even section 270A, there are immunity provisions and all of that which you can resort to. But it all depends on how good a job you did earlier, whether you had reasonable cause, whether your intentions were right, so on and so forth. When you and then you maybe you come out of the penalty provisions. So this was the presentation. I have tried to cover everything. There is a lot more. 2 hours is not justice enough to the topic. It's too wide. I've tried to do my best, but stay, and I know you will have a lot of questions. I urge you to go through the regulations when you do have some time and go slow and steady about learning the topic. It will help you. And if there are any questions, you can post it to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Aparna, ma'am. This session on WOW series was a really WOW session.
Thank you so much.
The insights that you have shared in such a short span was really commendable.
Thank you so much.
On behalf of WIRC, it is my proud privilege to cast a vote of thanks. Feeling gratitude and not expressing it is like wrapping a present and not giving it. Please accept our heartfelt gratitude for enthralling us through your words of wisdom.
Thank you so much.
We would like to express a deep sense of appreciation for guiding us on the topic and sparing your valuable time with us.
It's an honor, actually. I have not spared time. It's an honor that I've been called on this podium. It's very nice to give back to the profession. I've earned a lot intellectually through all the programs that WRC runs, and I'm happy to contribute in a small manner over here. Thank you so much.
Indeed, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions, Ashita, that I need to take?
There are two questions. First is both the range concept acceptable by tax department?
Yes, it is. It is mandatory. It is not subjective. You have to follow the law and you have to compute the range and give benefit to the taxpayer of it. And second question is 94B.
Under section 94B, what happens in the case EBI TDA is lost? How will the interest
no deduction.
Be computed?
You will not get deduction. No deduction in that year. You will carry forward the interest expense for set off in the later year.
I think that is all for the questions.
I think that's, yeah, okay.
Thank you very much,
you so
ma'am,
much. Thank
for
you.
Everything.
Thank
you
so
everything.
Much. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mishra, sir. Mishra ji.
I'll sign out.
Yes, yes, sure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Mishra ji, I'm end kar sakte.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Mishra ji. Thank you so much.
Come on. Thank you.
Thank you.